Hi,
Hey,
Frank.
good
Hi, how are
evening,
you?
guys.
Good
I'm all
evening.
right. Yeah.
Super. Excited for your talk, for your session here with us.
Yes, I see only the two of you, but I hope that many more will be out there watching us. So,
Yeah,
yeah, let's see.
unfortunately, this was what this edition was intended to be, an in-person event at the offices where you work, right? So you work at Schuberg Philis.
Yeah, we have a big room. Some of our audience may have been there during the Tweakers events. Like we can host easily a couple of hundred people in our space. And yeah, we would have loved to be on stage now, but
Well, we'll make
situations
the
have
best of it.
changed. But I am still quite excited to share a little bit with what I've been up to and why I get excited for, amongst other things, some of the stuff Azure has to offer, being relatively new to Azure. So yeah.
Very good. It would be very good to get your perspective on things. But before you can start, for me, the COVID measures also mean I don't have to travel as much, so I have some time, extra time, and I try to use that time to learn new things. What is the coolest thing you have learned last year?
The coolest thing I've learned last year. I think I had the pleasure last year of really diving into both AWS and Azure. So I joined Schuberg maybe 1.5 years ago, and before that I didn't really have had any experience with a cloud at all. And I got to learn a little bit about AWS and about Azure. I got to use them both, got to compare them a little bit, and some things are still a mystery for me, but other things I was pleasantly surprised by how easily I could pick them up and grasp them. And I could already see how it would have made my life a couple of years ago so much easier having the tools at my disposal. So yeah.
Very cool. Thank you. And I think you can just take it away. We're very
Yeah.
excited to hear your story on data and Azure Synapse Analytics. And I'm not going to spoil
Yeah.
everything for you.
We'll just stop now, okay? I'll take it
I'll
over
take a
from here.
time
No
out.
worries, no
Just take
worries.
it away.
Thank you. Thank you, Roland. All right, let me share my screen. Yes, the title of my talk, yeah, Getting Rid of Silos, Embracing MLOps, Democratize Data. It all sounds very catchy, but how do you actually do it? Well, this is a lousy title. I basically want to talk to you guys about some cool piece of tech that I got excited about, and I think it can maybe solve some of the problems behind these slogans that people keep shouting at us. Before I want to dive into this, I want to give a brief overview of who I am and where I am at the moment in my journey. I started life as a physicist. So on the very top left, you see Bart Simpson. I could walk into my lab every day wearing shorts and flip-flops. I was doing stuff with lasers in a lab, resulting in me getting a PhD in physics in Leiden. And then I started to think seriously about a more grown-up job. And then at some form or the other, I ended up in finance. I became a risk management consultant, a quant, if that resonates with you. So all of a sudden, I was working at the Zuidas in Amsterdam. I needed to wear suits. So I went from wearing shorts and flip-flops to suits. And I basically made models for different banks, mainly for mortgage portfolios. And I did that for about 3 years with a bunch of cool colleagues. I joined it immensely. What I didn't like that much was that we all built models from a regulatory point of view, so there were lots of hoops we needed to jump through, and it got a bit tiring. So I thought it's time for a change. And then I, by accident, came in contact with Schuberg Philis, the company I now work for. And I am now this sort of mad data scientist that you see on the top right. I get to wear whatever the F I want. And I get to do some pretty cool things, of which I would like to share a little bit with you today. So I would like to highlight and use my time with the banking industry as sort of a scaffold for this talk. And I would like to show you a little bit what environment I was working in, what I was part of. So I was part of the modeling department, the quants department, and thinking that we are the center of the world, I've drawn myself in the middle. And We had one job. We needed to create good models. Well, obviously, for good models, we need data. We need data to build our models on. So typically, I went to the historical data team and said to them, hey, can you give me some data? Because their job is to create and deliver quality data sets. And then they came back to me with like, yeah, okay, but can you specify them? What data fields do you need? And I was like, well, I don't know yet. Just give me all of them. You might have heard this, right? These annoying data scientists that want access to all data and then figure out themselves what to use. Well, we went back and forth quite a bit between me going to them, they coming to me. Well, actually, for each request I did, they also needed to look into the source system. So they needed to go to the production IT systems. Hence, there is a dashed line all the way over to IT run to actually see what kind of data we have available in the systems. So their life was also not that easy. Then on the very right, I already mentioned that IT run, believe it or not, once I've made a model, I needed to write a model document. I needed to write down with formulas what my model looks like such that the IT run department can copy those formulas and implement them into their systems. So we're not shifting like packages or deployed models. No, on a piece of paper, they needed to reproduce my model in their system. Doesn't feel quite efficient to me, but this is the way it was done. And in the end, right, I make models for other people, for stakeholders, for model users, right? They are my business, my client I need to make a model for. And their job, among other things, is to actually understand the model impact. So if we are going to put this model into production and it is version 2.0, right? What is then the impact compared to 1.0? How will it affect my business line? So we see different departments, and what I've learned over the last year, learning more about Azure, what it has to offer, I think we can use some of the technology, not per se to make one big team out of it, but to make our lives a little bit easier by having maybe a shared tool set or a shared resource set, we might be able to work more closely together. And I would like to highlight this a little bit in 5 steps. So I would like to start off to show a little bit how Synapse can be used as a data source. So this is item one, right? So the historical team could maybe get data out of Synapse, being sort of a production system. Then I would like to show how Machine Learning Studio can be used to actually prep data and store data and make it available to others. Then how I, as a quant, can use Machine Learning Studio to make models. Then I would like to spend some time to actually show how we can implement models, both in maybe a new way, but also compatible with the old way. And I'll come back to that in a second, what I mean with this. And finally, I would like to show a little bit, sort of a sneak preview, how we can use maybe automated ML within Azure Machine Learning Studio to help business stakeholders understand better what the data and the model actually is doing. So before going into this, let's sort of in three minutes time, take a pause and spend a couple of words on what actually Synapse and Machine Learning Studio is. Synapse is a product by Azure that has been in the works for a couple of years. It keeps evolving. And the picture you see on the left is something I just plucked from the internet, but I think it depicts quite well where I think Microsoft would like to go with it. It sort of ties in between Power BI, machine learning, other parts of the ecosystem. It sits sort of in the middle. And why is this? Well, it's both a data lake. It also offers a SQL data warehouse. It offers some analytics. You can do stuff with Spark in that as well. So it's sort of this partner that sits in the web of all the other resources. And today I would like to use a little bit of the SQL data warehouse to see how we can retrieve data, put a model into production in Synapse actually. And maybe in the next session, in another session, we can dive further in some of the native stuff that Synapse also has to offer. Well, On the other hand, we have Machine Learning Studio. Me being a data scientist, for me, this is my playground. I can use Jupyter Notebooks in here. I can prep data, store data. I can do labeling jobs. I can control compute resources. There's even a no-code solution to make machine learning models. I can track my models. You can do a lot. As you may see, I am quite a fan, or I'm becoming quite a fan of it. And I hope by the end of my talk, you see some of the beauty of what this tool has to offer as well. And then without further ado, let's go back to this overview picture. I will swap back a little bit between this and the web browser where I have Synapse and Machine Learning Studio running to sort of guide you through my narrative. So let's see, do I need to swipe left or right? I need to swipe right. Let's have a look at Azure Synapse. So let's see how it can be used as a data source. Well, if you open Azure Synapse, here you see we have a playground at Schuberg Phyllis to play around in Azure. We have several things we can look at. So we have data, develop, integrate. So let's have a look at data. Because in data, you can see you can have, let's hope, linked workspaces. We have some data lake storage, and we have in workspaces, we can make a SQL database. And in this case, I've made a database for this Azure Thursday demo in which I have stored some data. So let's have a look at what this data precisely is. And we see here that this data, it's a relatively simple data set, but I hope it will speak to the imagination of everyone. It's about New York City taxi trips, and we can see whether this trip was tipped or not, what the fare amount was, the payment type, passenger count, trip distance in miles, I guess, because it's the US, trip time in seconds, and the time of the day when the driver was, or when the driver picked up the passenger. And suppose that this is a system where data keeps being fed into on a daily basis. I myself actually did it from a CSV file in the Lake store. I loaded it into SQL, but imagine this is a system which is continuously data is being added. And I somehow would like to have a model that can predict for these features whether the taxi trip was tipped or not. And we can maybe imagine that with more passengers, people are maybe more likely to tip, or whether the distance was longer, or the time of day truly matters. So let's see if we can figure this out and make a model and also put that model back into production. So this is my production system. This is where my data lives. This is where my historical data team can source their data. And let's see how maybe in Machine Learning Studio, we can prep this data a little bit and make it readily available for consumption by others. So let's move over to Machine Learning Studio. And then when you open this, lots of things happening again on the left, several things going on. First thing I've done when I've opened Machine Learning Studio, I made some compute resource. So you see, I have here a instance running. I also have one currently not running that actually has a GPU for when I do really intensive stuff for which I need lots of compute power. You can easily make new resources, etc. It's really quite handy. Then what I've done, I simply go to notebooks. I've done my homework, obviously. So I've prepped something. You get a bit of file structure. And let's see, I have here a Jupyter notebook. It's running on my compute instance. It runs in a certain environment. I've already loaded up my functions. And let's now simply connect to this workspace. So what it simply does, it will retrieve all of the information needed to communicate with who I am within Machine Learning Studio. And let's simply do something very basic. I'm going to retrieve the same data as I just shown in Synapse. And I will load it into a data frame. I've written a small function. It will connect via ODBC to the AT Demo 1 database. And we can actually verify now that by running this command, indeed, it has loaded the data frame, 10,000 rows. We indeed get our columns back. Now I need to do some very small data transformation step. I need to change some data types because later on we're going to use the Onyx package. Then I will explain why this really matters. But now that I've have my data, maybe it's a good time to actually register my data set. So I can I use my workspace object. I have given my blob store name. I can connect to my data store and I can put my I can register my data frame as a data set. And why would I do this? Well, I sometimes hear that data scientists, we are called scientists for a reason, we can be quite messy. I had instances where people asked me, hey, can you reproduce this model? And what data set did you use? I was like, oh gosh, darn it, let me have a look. This will help me in this situation. By registering this data set, we see, right, it has registered the data set, successfully created and registered a new data set. We can go to assets, data sets, and let's see if this New York City tip data set is there. And we see New York City's tip data set, version 5, created 13th of January in literally a minute ago. We registered this data set. So apparently by doing this, I have made a new version. I can actually click on it. I can see that the version was created by me. I can go back to different versions. I can see how I need to consume this data. So it already generates some Python code that shows me how I can use this data. I can explore my data as well. And I can even see what models, if any, make use of this data set. So why do I get excited about this? Well, it takes only two lines of code to do something that is actually quite essential when you work at a bank, to make something auditable and traceable, to show evidence of how you created your model. I actually, together with colleagues, have written packages at banks to make sure we could register this, because only thing we had was a Python running locally on a laptop. We would have been helped greatly by having this at our disposal. Well, another thing we could do, a data science-y thing, we remove a little bit of outliers. Not going to go into detail, but there are some weird stuff in this data set. And let's split up this data set in a train and a test set. And once we've done this, what might also be a good thing to do is maybe let's also register this train and test set as well, right? So we can see it has created these data sets. We can verify here. Ah, indeed, right? Version 6 now, indeed, 13th of January, just seconds ago. And we have basically prepped our data set and created the data sets with which we can start do our analysis. So if we go back to our overview here, right? I can easily imagine that a historical data team can use Synapse to gather data, make data queryable, maybe even make some views available within a SQL database. And we can maybe use indeed Machine Learning Studio to do some further data prep and then register this data set to make it readily available for consumption. Well, some people might ask, well, right, is this using SQL not a bit old-fashioned? Why not use this data lake and just skip the whole SQL step? Well, I still find that there are good reasons for having SQL stick around. A columnar data store where you can use indices and foreign key constraints can be quite handy in a production setting to have some built-in guarantees that there are no duplicates in your records and stuff like that. And it will also come in handy when we are going to deploy our model later on. So having sort of done one and two, let's see now if we can create a good model. So let's go back and let's start doing some data science-y stuff. So just to show that this is not all PowerPoint and it is actually working, let's see if we can look at each of the different features in the data set. And let's have a look at this histogram. How is the data distributed? And we can see that maybe on average, the fair amount was maybe $7, $8, $9, $10. We can also look at, hey, right, if we make bins out of this fair amount, do we see a difference in the fraction of tips received? So if you look at between zero and maybe $4.75, we see that maybe a bit more than 50% was tipped. And we could maybe see a sort of trend that the more people spend, the more likely they are to tip. And we can do some analysis for all of these features. And in the end, maybe it's nice to have a table sort of summarizing by feature name how well they predict being tipped or not. And we see actually that payment type is a very good risk driver. And without knowing what payment type is, one and two, I can imagine it must be either cash or by card. But that is why it's always nice to have a business stakeholder, somebody who knows about the business to talk to say, hey, does it make sense that I see this in my data? Well, then another built-in feature that I actually quite like is to help with the traceability, we can start an experiment. And we can use this experiment to log information what we are about to do. So let's give it a name. Let's simply start logging. We can log metrics with this experiment. We see up top that we've started the experiment. We can attach pictures to this experiment. Now I'll show you in a second as well what kinds of overviews we can get back from this. Next up, I made a small pipeline, including a logistic regression model. It's not the most fancy model, but I always try it at first because it's an easily explainable model. I actually can write it on a piece of paper. And remember, I didn't have the luxury to send the package to a production environment. I needed to write on a piece of paper how my model looked like. So we've done this as well. And let's also calculate what the model performance is. And we see overall, this is a good. It's almost one. One is the highest score. It's a good model. I, as a data scientist, get excited about this. Now, then let's store this model. So we take this classifier object, and let's write it as a pickle file, as a package somewhere. And we can then use this pickle file, this model path, to actually also register our model. So remember, right? We registered our data sets. We can now also register our model. We give it some description of what it is. We can even attach the data sets that we used. We give it some tag as well. It is actually registered. And let me also end my experiment. And let's see. So we see in the top right as well, experiment ended. Let's see now what we get for free by having a couple of lines of code. What type of evidence is being gathered for us? Well, let's first go to models. We see New York City tip prediction version 9 created 13th of January, literally a minute ago. We can see some of the tags. It's created by me as an author. We can click on the model. Then we can see some other information. We can look at the versions. So you can see I've been playing around with this for roughly a week. We can actually also see the artifact, right? So the model object itself. We can maybe see if this used in an endpoint. No, not yet. We can also see the data sets that we used to make this model. So to me, right, we already know how to version our code. We now have a way to version our data sets, and we have a way to version our models. And this is something that comes to me immediately to my mind when I hear about MLOps, right? We know about DevOps, way of working, and how to use versioning, everything is code. We can register stuff, and we can do for making models using data. We want to also register our models in our data, and we have only a couple of lines. We can make use of the built-in functionality. So me being sometimes the messy scientist, this will help me create some structure for me. We also still have these experiments open. So let's have a look see here. You can see Loft submitted minutes ago. Let's have a look. What do we then get here? Well, basically, we see a summary of all of the experiments performed by me. And we also get an overview of the metrics I provided. So we get a nice graph as well. So if I'm in the process of trying to tweak and find the best model, this can be my logbook of all the experiments I've done, and I can see, hey, right, I can see maybe trends in my model performance going up or down, and I can use this to help guide me further in the process of building better models. So I like it. I don't need to have any more a written notebook to keep track of my experiments and faults. It's built in. So coming back to this point, so me as a quant, not always caring about hygiene, I have quite some tools at my disposal to make my life and the life of the auditors, the life of my colleagues, much, much better. Let's now see if I can also do the same for my colleagues at IT Run. So can I send to them my handwritten document with my formulas, or can we also do something over there? Now I'm going to show you a couple of different options how we can approach this problem. One way we can do is, in a more modern way, is we can create an endpoint. I will not actually run this live because it will take roughly 10, 15 minutes. But trust me that it works. We can look at the results and see if it is actually working. Because you can see on the 6th of January, I actually did this. And if you look at endpoints, so I may be forgetting to explain what we are doing here. We are taking the model we've just registered and we're gonna deploy it in a container instance. And it only takes 3 lines of code and then 15 minutes wait time. And then we can see an endpoint. Hey, right, we have here indeed this endpoint created 6th of January by me, container instance. This still uses model version 3, actually. So it's an older model version. It again shows us how we can consume stuff. So I've used both AWS and Azure a little bit. And what I like about Azure is that it gives you pointers how you need to consume stuff. I find that in AWS, I'm always a little bit searching for how do I actually access it. But let's see if this endpoint actually works. So I can take this address, and now I need to swipe right where I have Postman open. I have this address here, and I can submit some data. So here we see the features for fair amount, payment type, passenger count. And if I hit send, I get something back. What do I get back here? I get 0.999 and 0.00009. Well, the first item is the probability that somebody will not tip. And the second one is that the customer will tip. So in this instance, it's very unlikely that the customer will tip. But if I change something, for example, I change payment type from 2 to 1, and I do it again, then it's almost a 95% chance that our passenger will tip. So this is actually, we can send data to this container instance and we get our model output back. So I would consider this to be already a model in production, but it's only for a single record instance. There's also an option, I'm not going to show it, but to do a batch job. But I would like you to focus on the third option. So I consider this deploying it via an endpoint as sort of the new option. Imagine that whenever a new data point enters our data lake or data warehouse, we can use this endpoint to score our record. But maybe we can also use something that is maybe a bit more familiar to people with an IT run who naively or natively know a lot more about SQL, for example, than I do. So let's see if we can make our model also available in Synapse and use it in SQL. For that, we're going to convert our model object into a ONNX type model. And ONNX is the Open Neural Network Model Standard, if I think correctly on the top of my head. And it's basically a sort of standardized way of exchanging models between different systems. And what we're going to do is we're going to register this model as well. For this, we actually use MLflow. And I will explain in a minute why this is important. But we need to register it in the appropriate way that Synapse can also use it, that the correct metadata is attached to our model. And we can see created version 6, and we can actually see in models, version 6, 13th of January, awesome, has created our model version. So let's see now what we can do with this in Synapse. So instead of me sending a piece of text with formulas to ITRun, can we do something different as well? Here we see some tables, and the cool thing is, before showing this, let me quickly check. Yes, in Synapse, I've set up a linked service between my Azure Machine Learning Studio and Synapse itself. And once I've done that, I can do the following. I can right click on a table, and I have now the option available, machine learning, predict with a model. This sounds exciting. So let's see what happens if I press this. Then we see, hey, right, Azure Machine Learning, it will start to connect to my Azure Machine Learning service. And we can see here, yeah, model version 6, the one we just created, I can select it, and I automatically already get the mapping from my source columns in my table and how they map to my model input. This is actually why we use MLflow to package our models, because we need to give this metadata to automatically fill in this type conversion. Otherwise, it will not work. So it's still a little bit in, as I will show later, it's still a bit in preview, but it works. If I now press continue, what do I need to do? Okay, store object in the database, save the prediction script as a stored procedure. Okay, let's do a stored procedure. Azure first day demo procedure. Load model in database table. Okay, so he will load the model. Let's load the model in the existing AML models table. What will happen now when I press deploy plus open script? Synapse will make a stored procedure, which we'll see in a minute. And it will retrieve the model from Machine Learning Studio, and it will sort of stage it in a SQL table, in particularly in this SQL table. So let's see what happens. Uploading the model, deploying the model. So far, so good. The query has been generated successfully. Okay, that looks promising. So what do we see actually here? And I'm not a SQL expert. I barely know that this is a common table expression. But what I actually like about it, in my mind, in sort of the old school world, in large corporate companies, SQL is abundant. There's a lot of built-up knowledge on how to use stored procedures, on how to build triggers, on how to schedule jobs. So having a stored procedure that takes our data from our table and then uses the tsql predict command to select the right model from our table and then sort of applies this model to this data. So now let's see what happens if I press execute. And so here we can see our original columns, but now also our model prediction. So I can completely imagine that I am a data scientist. I'm the quant. I build models left and right. This is what I do. I register them, and the only thing now that I need to do is I need to communicate with my counterpart that is responsible for maintaining this production environment. Hey, I think I have a new model. Can we create a job that will populate the table every day? Because the BI reporting department would like to have their dashboards updated daily. Or I can maybe say, hey, right, I have a new model version. Can we update the job, and the only thing that we need to update is maybe the versioning in our stored procedure. And for me, this is where sort of old world meets new world. We we can still have different roles and different responsibilities. But we can use new technology to make our life easier, to make the exchange of information easier, to make throughput times easier. That's why I got excited last year learning more about Azure and using these tools. So in my mind, I think we can very much still have these different teams, the historical data team, a modeling team, and maybe a more IT production focused team. But by having a shared tool set in the middle, we have a more easy way of talking to each other, of exchanging information, of models of data. In the end, having maybe a faster time to market for our ideas, or maybe helping our business stakeholder better. Speaking of which, I promised you to also help our business stakeholder, because I make a new model and he simply needs to swallow that there is some impact. Well, I can convince him that there is an impact, or there's no impact, or that the data is indeed as it is, by also offering him something. So let's see if we can offer him something by using automated ML. And I know it's a little bit of a dirty word under within data scientists, right? Having something without code or limited code, but it has its benefits. I will show you. So let's go back to Machine Learning Studio. Let's go to automated ML. Let automated ML train and find the best models without writing a single line of code. Well, that sounds like a big promise. Let's see if that is true. All right, so create a new automated ML run, select the data set. Oh, nice. So I now see already the data sets that are available in my data store. That is nice. So let me select my train set. What's up next? Okay. Let's create a new experiment. Azure First Day Demo Automated ML. That sounds good. Black target column. What is the target column? Okay. What we want to try to predict. Yes, we want to try to predict the whether there was a tip or not. I need to select my compute instance. Let's select the thing that I have running. Next. Select a task, okay. Classification to predict one of several categories. In the target, yes, no, blue, green, yeah, this sounds right. Yes, no, we want to predict tipped, yes or no. So this also seems good to me. Validation type, auto sounds good to me. Test data set, yeah, I remember that we have a test data set. So let's also select this test data set. Cool, finish. All right. This job is simply going on, and you might now wonder, hey Frank, but do you really expect a business stakeholder to also do this themselves, right? Well, the reason I'm showing you this is twofold. One, I would like to show you how easy it is without any code to do this. You can actually also execute this job by writing a couple of lines of code. But what I like most is what you get out of it. So let's have a look while this is running at a run that is already complete. What's happening here? We see lots of information again, some performance metrics, what data set is being used, created by me. But we get more. We get data guardrails, so it tells us something about whether we've done the validation split correctly, whether there was some class imbalance, something about missing features. Don't know precisely what it means, but it's all green, right? So it must be good. So it basically what it does, right? It tries, in this case, more than 90 different types of models to find the best model. Well, me as a business stakeholder might not be interested in all the varieties. I simply want the best model, but I see something else that draws my attention. View explanation. That seems promising. So what do I get? Okay, so hey, I see aggregate feature importance. So I see somehow how each feature is contributing to my model. Okay. Well, this already tells me something about my model. So I'm learning something about my model. I like it. Individual feature performance. Okay. Oh, I get fair amount. Let's see, probability. Can I do so? Oh. Hey, select your access value. Okay, data set, fair amount. Let's do trip distance. Okay, oh. This seems also nice. So I get also a way to interactively explore the data. So I can see, for example, trends and patterns. So in my mind, if I try to imagine, right, being a business stakeholder or a data expert, I have an empirical gut feeling of how my data should look like. I can explore it here. I can have a look here in the same tool set as that my quant counterpart is making my model in. I can directly ask him questions. We can have the same interface to talk to. Nice. I like it. So I've now sort of narrated this a little bit from the perspective of this business stakeholder, but actually I would use it myself as well. While I am playing with my data, trying to understand my data set better, why not have it run in the background, doing a brute force search of all the best models out there? Why not help yourself with a computer on your side, trying to find patterns in your data and trying to find the best model? It makes my life at least easier. So I'm nearing the end of my talk, and I hope to have given you guys a little bit of the flavor and the excitement that I have for these types of tools. And by having this sort of context from my previous career as a quant in a bank wearing the suit, that you can sort of see why it would have helped at least me and my colleagues immensely having these tools at our disposal. Well, it's not, if you are as excited as me, right? What to do next? Well, I would say just get started. I followed, amongst other things, this link with a tutorial on this, using these SQL pools and this model scoring wizard. That was nice to follow. Some things that I learned is Machine Learning Studio is cost-wise, it's relatively cheap. It's also easy to control. You can put a schedule on whether to spin up and spin down compute instances. With Synapse, it's a little bit more tricky. The dedicated SQL pools can become a little bit expensive. And you need to manually pause your SQL pool to prevent you from making more costs. So I will do this after this talk. I will also pause my SQL pool. And I learned that the scoring wizard in Synapse is still in preview. And it may be a bit of a technical detail, but we are using some Python libraries, in this case sklearn. We converted the model coming out of it into ONNX, and then we must somehow make this ONNX model play nicely with Synapse. And at each interface, there are knobs to tune to make it work correctly, and it can be a little bit of a pain. So I learned this the hard way over the last few weeks. Don't let it deter you or keep you down, I would say. Happy hacking. And if you would like to know more, or if you would like to brainstorm about this latter part, about how to tie all these things together and make it work in Synapse as well, just reach out to me on LinkedIn. With that said, I would like to thank you all for your attention. I cannot see you, but I know you're out there. I see Roland coming back in. I know that Roland was there at least. Thank you, and Roel as well. And I will give up my screen.
Thank you so much. It was so great, and you shared it with... I didn't feel dumb watching you present this very... heavy stuff, because there's some very powerful things going on here, because you're now showing this it looks that easy that I think I could even do it. Well, I've experimented some with the older Machine Learning Studio. The portal has enriched greatly, but it's a very nice session. It was very nice how you did it. I really loved it. And
cool,
we have
glad
some,
you like it.
Some questions. Yeah. And the first one is from Bart from YouTube, and I think I can show it on the screen. And it is, how can we publish the models and expose these APIs that we create through the machine learning studio? How can we expose them to external parties? And how can we secure those? Do you have any take on that?
Yeah, it's a good question. It's something that we ourselves are also still a little bit exploring with, because at the moment of writing, we are deploying Synapse for one of our customers. And so now I wade into engineering territory. So I will start to feel dumb at the moment, Roland, but I know that we are having some struggles with trying to make it all VNet integrated and make it secure. So at the moment, I'm doing this in my Schuberg Phyllis playground. It's secure by our standards, but not production ready secure. This is actually something I still need to look into. So this API that I was showing you, I can give you the web link and you can use it as well, right? So you can fire at it at will.
Yeah.
I would not know honestly yet how I need to secure this, how I need to build an interface around this.
And thank you. We the engineers can help there, because
right? Yeah, yeah.
And container instance, so we can secure that container instance like we would do any other container instance in Azure. So we can protect that there. I'm not sure how it is key wise. You probably need a key as well to invoke the API. But that is, of course, you can manage that, because that is a production scenario.
Yeah.
You will face probably. But what I really loved was a Synapse integration you showed us. I had not seen that before, and it was so powerful to see how easy it was. And you explained it very well, that there is an entire generation almost of engineers that knows SQL from the back of their hand, and they don't know nothing about machine learning. And this is their entry point to just using those models with a syntax they already know. So there was
and I honestly believe that there is still a future out there for having a SQL data warehouse. I can imagine so many use cases and scenarios. So why force us to move away from something that seems old and cannot keep up with the latest tech and features out there? So I like that this is bridging the gap between old and new.
Yeah, very much. Thank you. In regard to throughput in Synapse, how many records can we score at once? Because the warehouse can contain huge amounts of data. Is there some limits to that?
So what I showed at the moment, to give a bit of context, this was simply 10,000 records being scored, and I used the very smallest SQL pool that I could find.
Okay.
So and in my experience, and this is why I think it's still in preview, if you bring more complex models to production, somehow the compute in Synapse is not fully optimized to handle those more complex models. So going from a logistic regression to a random forest to some decision trees, some boosting or neural networks, you can see a steep increase in compute time.
Yeah.
That, in my gut feeling, is not related to record size, it's or data size. It's more on the model complexity compute end of view.
So there's still an optimization.
Yes, but having said that, I was pleasantly surprised by the speed of the logistic regression model. And it may be old-fashioned, but lots of banks, this is the backbone of the models within credit risk. So already within that setting, I can see many, many applications.
Very cool. I think I know that I written down my questions, and I shouldn't do that because I'm now looking down.
Can I do one in the meantime,
please.
Roland? So right there at the end, you show that the system determined what the best fitting model was.
Yeah.
How? I mean, I don't understand any of this. So how does that work? How does it have an opinion about 10 models and which one's best?
Yeah. So the funny thing is, the machine is actually doing 70 or 80 repetitions of what I was showing as code in Python. So I need to tell to Python, or in this case to the machine, hey, this is the column you need to build a model for. Find me patterns that explain what you see in this column. Then I also say to him, right, all the other columns are basically your playground, your garden, from which you can choose and try to match what you see in this column as maybe patterns in the other column as well. So for a human, it's easy. If you have only two columns, you simply plot them, X versus Y, and see, hey, right, I see this wavy pattern in it. This is how I should relate this one to this one. Our mind as a human cannot do this for more than two, because then we need to start to think in multiple dimensions and it blows up. But a computer can easily do this. It can take many, many columns and try to find patterns to explain what he sees in this single column. And he does this systematically. He tries this with method A, with method B, with method B, with option one, with option two. He brute forces it. So it may appear to be a smart computer, but he just tries a lot.
And he had a really easy time, right? This data set, because there was one feature, I think it was payment type. It was
that did extremely well. Yeah. So I also played around with this automated ML of a much more complicated data set. I took one from a competition, a Kaggle competition. And I basically within 1 hour I had the same score as the top scoring model on Kaggle. So, and that I find powerful, because then I can shift my focus from building models, doing the nitty-gritty sort of all of the writing code. I can then spend time on understanding the data, on understanding the impact of the model for the business. I can help explain my model to the business. And then I can do the part that I like as a data scientist as well. Yes, I get enjoyment of building models, but it's the connection with why I do it that gets me excited.
You get to do the science part in the data science, right?
Yeah, because yeah. It's then we get to talk about, hey, but I, as an expert, expect that this feature is very important. Why is it not in your model? And then you're like, yeah, you make a point. Let's look into this. And then we start iterating, right? That's where the experimentation comes from. And that's where it's nice, where we have an environment where we can log our experiments, our incremental process. And then somebody's like, okay, damn, there was an error in our production system. Our data is not good. Let's give you new data. Then we're like, okay, we need to register this. And now we have a place where we can register our new data set as well. So this whole iterative cycle, we get all of the tooling in place to focus on the thing that matters, the process, how to get to the best model.
Yeah, so cool. One last question, if you would permit it. Is there any A-B testing features going on there? Because I could expect you have multiple versions of the model, and maybe you just want to try them out in production because you have this data, your training set, your test set that is, I hope it is representative of the production environment. Maybe you're getting really other results from production. Is there a way to have them both there out in the wild and compare them?
Yeah, I would say so. I haven't thought of using multiple model versions to do A-B testing, but I would say, right, you've seen me click the stored procedure and select a version. I can easily make another stored procedure of a different version and have it score two tables side by side and try to compare what's out there. Yeah, why not?
Very cool. Thank you.
Makes sense.
Well, thank you so much. I think we're out of questions and we're almost out of time, so we can have a small break. So Frank, it was amazing. It was an amazing session. Thank you so much for being with us. And I hope we meet in person somewhere this year when we finally get to without these really weird COVID measures. So thank you so much.
Thank you for having me. I had fun, and we'll see each other again.
Excellent.
For sure.
Thank you.
All right.
Thanks.
Take care, guys. Bye-bye.
Same to you. Bye-bye.